By playing in dozens of studio sessions like this, working, as John said, on countless radio shows, and picking up evening gigs as well, Tommy Dorsey weathered the depression. But he and Jimmy nurtured one dream: to lead their own orchestra. They hired the young trombonist Glenn Miller as arranger, and a cast of other up-and-coming players. And after a somewhat slow start, they were picked up in 1934 to play for a review at Ben Marden's Riviera Club, just over the George Washington Bridge from New York in New Jersey. It was organised by songwriter Jimmy McHugh.
Tommy and Jimmy Dorsey came along, I did a show, and I put their band in this particular show. In it was Paul Weston, Axel Stordahl, Ray McKinley was the drummer, Glenn Miller was the trombone player, and I think Charlie Spivak played the cornet. And this whole band only cost $1,400.
Just lost in a fog. My mind is hazy, my thoughts are blue. Guess I'll always be kinda lost in a fog without you. Waiting night and day. Like
the band's vocalist Bob Crosby singing the hit song by Dorothy Fields and Jimmy McHugh from the Riviera Review. But generally pleasant and inoffensive as Bob's singing was, it didn't go down well with Tommy Dorsey. John Chilton explains.
I had great pleasure in writing a book called Stomp Off, Let's Go, which was the story of Bob Crosby's big band and the Bobcats. And in doing so, I met up with Bob Crosby and found him to be a charming and helpful man. But he detested Tommy Dorsey. I can never forget how his eyes glistened with hatred when he spoke about Dorsey. He said he was a completely unpleasant person. I mean, this was 50 years after they'd collided. He couldn't forgive him. Tommy Dorsey could be rather cruel, and he kept holding his head in his hands, and with a theatrical sigh, he'd say, "They sent the wrong Crosby." This was, of course, a reference that he would have much preferred Bing Crosby, but Bob Crosby had moved from the West Coast to New York, and he was advised by Bing's agent, try his luck with bands in New York. And they said to Dorsey, what an asset Bob Crosby would be to the Brothers Band. Jimmy thought, yes, he'd go along with that, but Tommy, although he got on very well with Bing Crosby, he couldn't find any way of getting along, and it was what Bob Crosby called the unhappiest period of his life.
It wasn't only Bob Crosby who found this period an unhappy one. Cracks were beginning to show in the relationship between the brothers, each of whom had comparable measures of talent and ego, and the band seemed destined to blow apart as their quarrels about musical policy spread onto the bandstand. In June 1935, Tommy stalked off stage, and the partnership between the brothers came to an end. 11 years later, they were sufficiently reconciled to reenact the scene for the Embassy picture The Fabulous Dorseys. Directed by Alfred Green and produced by Charles R. Rogers, the film was one of the first jazz biopics. but its slender plotline and the fact that the love interests chat happily together throughout the only screen appearance of Art Tatum hasn't won it many fans in the jazz community. Nevertheless, the hostility between the brothers fairly fizzes off the screen in this scene, where an innocent dancer requests a song from Tommy.
Tommy, how about playing Never Say Never?
Please, Mr. Dorsey.
Customer wants Never Say Never.
But Tommy, remember rehearsal? We never did finish that number.
Ah, let's do it, but don't kick it off too fast. Never Say Never, boys. What was that for?
That's for playing it too fast.
No musician could do that to me in public, not even my own brother.
Why don't you lead the band right for a change?
When it comes to leading a band, I don't need any advice from you.
Look, let's play the numbers right, or not play them at all.
All right, we won't play them at all.
If you walk out now, it's for good.
Okay, for good.
Having stalked off stage, leaving Jimmy to run their former orchestra, Tommy lost no time in forming his own band. This is the new group he fronted, but as Zeke Zarkey explains, Tommy decided to take a shortcut in getting it started.
Tommy Dorsey decided to be a band leader. He wanted to get his own band. Well, what he did, he just hired everybody in Joe Hames' band. Joe Hames had a very highly regarded big band, and Joe was bitter till the end of his days about that. And when I joined Joe Hames' band as a result of him having to look for a new band, new guys, just reorganized from scratch. And I was one of the guys that was in that Joe Hames' band. And I used to ride in Joe's car on the one-night stands, which is mostly all that we did. And all I heard all the time was Joe Hames bitching about what a bad guy Tommy Dorsey was.
Bud Freeman, and before that, Tommy himself, soloing on That's a Plenty. This new band that Tommy'd set up was playing a style that's best described as big band Dixieland. The problem was that his former vocalist, Bob Crosby, the man he so disliked, was now leading a group that was, if anything, better than Tommy's at playing this style of jazz.
Well, to have had this person in your band and have got rid of them, and then they went on to lead a band that not only rivaled your own band for popularity, but was playing Dixieland so much more convincingly. Well, certainly with better soloists all around. And I think Dorsey thought, I'm going to get away from this. I'll go more for the swing man. So he got one of the leading arrangers of the day, Cy Oliver, who'd worked for about 6 years with Jimmy Lunceford's band.
Lunceford was everything that Dorsey's band wasn't. It was hard swinging, spontaneous, inventive. Zeke Zarkey, now 90 years old himself, remembers the thrill of hearing Lunceford for the first time.
I was working at a restaurant in Buffalo, New York, for a 3-week job up there with a pickup band from New York. And about the third night there, one of the musicians from Buffalo said, you guys ought to go down to Bluebird Ballroom in the colored section and listen to that band down there. And it was the Lunceford band. If you can imagine hearing, standing in front of that band and listening to that band, It's just one of the highlights of my musical life. That's all I can tell you. Fresh. Nobody heard anything like that, and nobody had ever seen anything like that. They were so relaxed and so full of spirit, putting everything into motion and sound was unbelievable. And when they came to New York, they just set the whole jazz world on its ear.
Tommy Dorsey summed up the various arrangements that Silo did and listened to them and scouted about the profession what was the general view of Silo, realised he'd got a conscientious and inspiring arranger, and signed him by saying, whatever Lunceford pays you, I'll give you $5,000 a year more. Well, Silo wasn't going to turn that up, that sort of opportunity, particularly as he got rather tired of working with Lunceford. So he joined and proceeded to contribute arrangements that really altered the face of the band. It was not the same band. Now, it wasn't the same band because within a year, there was only two left of the original band. People couldn't make the change in style.
Cy Oliver's Stomp It Off, recorded by the Tommy Dorsey Band in October 1939, and showing how completely Oliver had altered the sound of the band into something smoother, more swinging and relaxed. In the next programme, Dorsey adds the missing ingredient to his band, singer Frank Sinatra. But today I'll leave you with the thoughts of one of the finest of all arrangers, Nelson Riddle, who described how he felt about the band's arrangements on his first day's work in the trombone section a year or two after that last disc was made.
We had some arrangements which were written by a man named Cy Oliver, who had gravitated to Tommy Dorsey's band from the old Jimmy Lunceford Orchestra. And though Jimmy Lunceford had no strings, Cy Oliver somewhere along the way had learned to write for strings, and he would lay down this cushion of sustained strings over the pulsating rhythmic sound of the brass and the saxes for Tommy. It made it quite an interesting sound. Some of the old records that he did, for instance, Sunny Side of the Street was an example. Opus number 1 was an example. Swanee River was an excellent example of what I mean.
Cy Oliver's arrangement of Swanee River, played by the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra and ending the first part of 100 Years of Tommy Dorsey. The programme was produced and presented by Alyn Shipton.